Artist Series is proud to present Dr. Kevin Chance. Now is the time that I please ask you to turn off or silence all cell phones and refrain from the use of flash photography. Thank you and enjoy the performance.
of an audience since March 2020, I guess it was. And when I was thinking of what I wanted to play, I started thinking about all the pieces that attracted me to the piano in the first place. And it has been a chance for me to reconnect with some pieces that I played a long time ago, and also a chance for me to just revisit some of the gorgeous pieces that have been written for the piano. And in many ways, I think this program is a celebration of the poetry of Romanticism. The first piece you heard was Schumann's F-sharp major romance, which to me is just one of the most sublime pieces that was ever written for the piano. It's a gorgeous duet of the thumbs with everything surrounding it, the outer parts of the hand. The next piece you'll hear was written by one of Schumann's best friends, Johannes Brahms. This particular work are his three Intermezzi, Opus 117. And if you listen to a lot of Schumann, Schumann had a way with motives. Often we think of long, expansive melodies, and Schumann certainly knew how to write a long, expansive melody, but often it's based on little short segments. You can even hear that in the Intermezzo and the romance you just heard. Brahms took this to a whole nother level, and he had a way of developing these gorgeous pieces late in his life out of the tiniest little cells of material. And you hear that to some extent in these intermezzos. I feel like these three intermezzos represent the three stages of life. The first is a very beautiful lullaby, and he even puts a little incipit at the beginning with the text of a Scottish lullaby, so you'll hear some of the Scottish influences in it. The second of the intermezzos, I feel like, represents the middle age, the age of life I'm in right now, where you're searching and trying to find meaning with all you're doing in your life. And then the third intermezzo is one of the starkest pieces that Brahms wrote, and I feel like it very much is a reflection on the end of life. And in particular, the middle section of that third intermezzo, I feel like, is an absolutely gorgeous, nostalgic moment in his music, where he's reflecting back on wonderful, maybe even a little bit painful memories of love that was lost. If you know very much about Brahms, he was in love with Schumann's wife, Clara. Because he had so much respect for Robert, he never actually acted on his love for Clara, even after Robert had passed away. So there was always this sense of unrequited love, I think, in his music that carried all the way through a lot of the music by him that we know and love. So I hope you enjoy these three intermezzos by Brahms.
Thank you.
by Schumann. These are his scenes from childhood. And this is a piece that I studied when I was working on my doctorate. And just like everybody who endures a doctorate, you have to do some sort of big research project. And this was one of mine. And everyone said, well, why? What more was there to say about the scenes from childhood? Because this is a piece, you know, we've all known and heard for years. But I was driving around one day and listening to NPR, and Murray Pariah was interviewed, who's one of my favorite pianists, and at the time he was on tour with this set. And several people in the interview said, you know, talk about your interpretations. And he said, well, people that come hear me might not recognize the scenes from childhood because I went back to the original edition. And I thought, well, what in the world is he talking about? So of course I go back home and I scour through my editions. And there were a lot of interesting things that I found, enough to generate my doctoral lecture. So this piece was written when Schumann was in his late 20s, around 28, 29 years old. He was very much looking forward at this point in his life to having children. And the edition most of us play from is the one that Clara did much later in her life. And she did this edition of his music very much against her will, but Brahms convinced her to go ahead with it because she needed the money. So she produced this, what was called an instructive edition, which were very popular at the time. In an earlier edition she did of Schumann's work, she changed nothing. In this instructive edition, she changed quite a bit, including his tempo markings. If you know music, if you're a musician, you know, typically we see allegro on Dante, some sort of Italian term to give us a tempo indication. But this is one of the few pieces where Schumann completely did away with that, and all he put at the beginning were metronome marks, which some people have wondered if his metronome was broken, because some of his marks seem so fast. But he actually, in one of his, he wrote a letter to Burma, another composer at the time, asking Burma if his metronome was broken because his metronome mark seemed crazy, and he said, I just tested mine and it clicked 60 clicks per minute, which is what it should do. I feel like by the time Clara did this edition in her 60s, she was at a much different point in her life. She had had children. She also had been a caregiver for Robert as he was having the mental issues that he suffered with later in life. So she was at a much different place emotionally, probably than Robert was when he wrote the piece. I'm not gonna say I take every single metronome mark that's in the score. I've heard the piece the other way so long, I can't completely divorce my ears of it. But what I do try to respect are the relationships between the movements that Schumann clearly indicates. Some are indicated to be exactly the same tempo between movements. Some he wants there to be just a slight differentiation. So I feel like that's ultimately what he's trying to tell us with these metronome marks, and I feel like it makes the piece more cohesive. So I hope you enjoy Schumann's Scenes from Childhood. I think this is an incredibly beautiful set of pieces.
Thank you.
you'll hear tonight is by Chopin. I'll break out of the Schumann-Brahms relationship for one last piece. Chopin gave us four ballades, and this is the first of the four, but much like many of the romantics, his life was not without some amount of heartache. In particular, he was born in Poland, and due to all the civil strife and the awful things that were happening in Poland at the time, he left and went to Paris. But unfortunately, he had to leave his entire family behind. And I think we hear this struggle in so many of his works, particularly the polonaises and the mazurkas, where he's turning and looking back to the traditional dances from his native land. But I think it also permeates everything he wrote. And in particular, in the ballade, I think you hear that sense of nostalgia that we've talked about in some of the other pieces I played tonight, but in a more youthful way. Much like the scenes from childhood, Chopin was in his 20s when he wrote this piece, so he was still fairly young. The piece opens in a very unique way. It starts on a harmony it should not start on, and it takes a little while for it to find its way. So much like we talked about in the Brahms, in the second one, where it sort of wanders around, Chopin is exploring a very similar aspect of the music in this particular piece. But this will be the one piece on the program that does not end softly. I couldn't end everything softly, so I did want to pick one piece that gave you a little bit bigger finish, hopefully. I hope you enjoy the G minor ballade.